Alvarez talking about the science of Sherlock Holmes.
All right, thank you very much. Thank you. It's, is it care for one of these? It's, I want to thank you for coming this evening. I also want to thank a lot of the members of the Nashville Scholars from coming. I just saw Jim came in. Jim, I thought you said you were going to Poughkeepsie or something.
I refused entirely because I came this.
Oh, I see. Okay. I understand that. So we have several members here of the Nashville Scholars, and we're going to talk about that at the end a little bit if you're interested in joining our group. Basically, what I'm going to discuss is some of the literary elements and also the science part of some of the Sherlock Holmes techniques that take place in the stories and how they've evolved into present day in some circumstances. One of the things about this is that it's been depicted in 254 times. The Guinness Record Book has now announced that Sherlock Holmes has been awarded a world record for the most portrayed literary human character in film and television. The stories have been captured in over 106 different languages, and a friend of ours that we know, Don Hobbs, I was just in communication with him this past week, he has over 11,000 volumes in foreign language editions of Sherlock Holmes editions. The Sherlock Holmes stories have never gone out of print. They've always been in publication, and that's second only to the Bible in the number of publications that have occurred. Sherlock Holmes, to many, seems to be like a real person, and in fact, he's predicated and based on a real person, and that real person being Dr. Joseph Bell, who was his mentor and also at the University of Edinburgh when Arthur Conan Doyle was a medical student there. I want to show you a quick film clip of Arthur Conan Doyle talking about Dr. Joseph Bell. It's a rare, rare film clip.
And I think of turning scientific methods, as it were, onto the work of detection. And I used, as a student, to have an old professor, his name was Bell, who was extraordinarily quick at deductive work. He would look at the patient, he would hardly allow the patient to open his mouth, but he would make his diagnosis of the disease, and also very often of the patient's nationality and occupation and other points, entirely by his power of observation. So naturally I thought to myself, well, if a scientific man like Bell was to come into the detective business, he wouldn't do these things by chance. He'd get the thing by building it up scientifically.
So in essence, I'll show you a portrait of Dr. Joseph Bell here. And Bell, as I said, was his mentor, and what he would do with his students is that he would bring in patients into the room where the students were, and he in turn would make a diagnosis and ask his students to make a diagnosis of what it was that this was the ailment that they came in. I was going to do this today, but it takes too much time, and I do have to kind of move along, but I was going to get a concoction, a mixture for you to pass out and try one with you, but instead I'll just explain it to you. What he would do is he had this concoction, and what he did was he dipped his forefinger into the solution and then put it to his tongue. And then he would pass it around to the other medical students, and the students, as they would take, they would grimace, and they would just make these various faces and all this, you know, and they said, well, that's just awful. And he said, you see, and that was what Doyle was saying, he says, you see, but you do not observe. He says, when I put my forefinger in, I put it in to the solution, but then when I put it to my tongue, I use the other finger. And so that being the case, you see, that sometimes we're not really, we see things, but we don't really observe what it is that we see. This is, the next visual here is from Sidney Paget. And Sidney Paget was one of the illustrators in the early works of Arthur Conan Doyle's Sherlock Holmes stories. And you can see the type of features that are depicted from the Sherlock Holmes stories. One of the information I want to give you is that when Conan Doyle first started as a physician, you may have heard this, but he was on the South Seas. And what had happened was that in his first year, he only made 154 pounds in his practice. So he really wasn't getting a lot of money. And so when he filed his tax return to the tax assessor, he received a reply. And the reply said that this is quite unsatisfactory. And Holmes wrote back and said, it scrawled across the paper, I entirely agree. Well, they called him in to the board and the Board of Assessors called him in, and he had to justify his income. But what he did for the next 8 years, he sent a letter to the local newspaper criticizing the tax methods that were being used for assessments. So it's kind of interesting. One of the things I do want to point out, what I find to be kind of interesting in the stories from a literary perspective, is that Arthur Conan's brilliance to me is his use of Sherlock Holmes to exclude Watson, who is the narrator, and placing him in a realm of uncertainty by not revealing his mental model, which is an organization of one's knowledge and experience, world experience. And he does this with each case that you read. While Doyle presents the reader with an abundance of detail, his writing style prevents the uncovering of the final analysis until it's revealed by Holmes himself. It is Watson that determines the what and how much of the details are given to the reader, that either describes the setting, characters, and circumstances that the reader needs to immerse with them, and together with the analogies, the images, and the metaphors that occur throughout each story. These literary devices are threaded in such a way that separate the Sherlock Holmes stories and continues to interest present-day readers. Each of the four novels and most of the short stories are told from the first-person past tense point of view. There's only two stories in which Sherlock Holmes writes, and that's the Lion's Mane and the Blanched Soldier, and then two are in the third person, and that is his Last Bow and the Mazarin Stone. These stories present those details that stimulate suspense and interest to the reader of the mystery from three different but similar perspectives as you read those. I want to just give you a little context for where a lot of this information comes from. The Hundred Years' War was a series of actions between England and France from 1337 to 1453. It's within this time period that the siege of Harfleur took place in 1415, and Henry V came over and was victorious in that battle. And this engagement caused Shakespeare to write this particular quote from Henry V, and it's Act 3, Scene 1. And if you take a look at it, it says, "I see you stand like greyhounds in the slips, strained upon the start. The game is afoot." Well, I highlighted the game is afoot because a lot of us have heard the game is afoot, you know, and we associate it with Sherlock Holmes saying the game is afoot, when actually it comes from Shakespeare's quotation out of Henry V. He's not alone in that. I'm going to talk about some other Shakespearean quotes that he uses in his stories. For example, Sherlock Holmes quotes, Holmes is not confined to just this one item, but he does a lot of different Shakespearean quotes. For example, I've listed a few here on the overhead, but his words appear in several of the stories of the canon. For example, Hamlet is cited in at least five of the stories in which he writes. For example, upon reading Mycroft's telegram and the Bruce Partington plans, Sherlock paraphrases Hamlet by saying, "Who is Cardigan West, and what is he to Mycroft?" And you see the Hamlet is this very close to what he says in that rendition. He also says, in The Adventure of the Empty House, Shakespeare states, "I trust that age does not wither or custom stale my infinite variety." And Sherlock Holmes paraphrases Shakespeare's Antony and Cleopatra, "Age cannot wither her, nor custom stale her infinite variety." Holmes has a habit of rephrasing several Shakespearean quotes, such as, "Thrice his arm that hath his quarrel just," which is from Henry VI. And in The Disappearance of Lady Carfax, Holmes says, "Thrice is he armed who hath his quarrel just." And he also quotes Holmes directly in The Adventure of the Empty House, where he says, "Journeys and ends in lovers' meetings." And that's from Twelfth Night. But Holmes is not confined to paraphrasing Shakespeare. He shows his knowledge of American writer Henry David Thoreau, who's the author of Walden. And I looked at Thoreau's journal, and in November of 1854, Thoreau writes in his journal, "Some circumstantial evidence is very strong, as when you find the trout in the milk." And then Holmes refers to this Thoreau's example by saying, in The Adventure of the Noble Bachelor, when explaining to Watson how his conjecture evolves into certainty, that circumstantial evidence is occasionally very convincing, as when you find the trout in the milk. Sherlock Holmes quotes, or should I say misquotes, in The Red-Headed League, Gustave Flaubert's letter to George Sand. And the original quote is in French, obviously, and then in the story itself, it's this is the rendition that's given, but a literal, an English translation is that man is nothing, the work is everything. So those are some references that are made within those particular items. Charles Dickens is not, from the Pickwick Papers, is quoted directly in one of the stories, which is Charles Augustus Milverton. And when Dr. Watson's description of the evil villain, Charles Augustus Milverton, it comes directly out of Charles Dickens' The Pickwick Papers, and this is the exact quote that appears in the story, and it also appears in the Charles Dickens' Pickwick Papers novel. Metaphors, analogies, use of adjectives and imagery frequently appear throughout the stories in the canon and turn detail from a device that supports the story to one that the story solely relies upon. And you're going to see a lot of these types of metaphors that Doyle uses in the Sherlock Holmes stories, as well as images and so forth. Here's an example I've got from A Study in Scarlet. I'm not going to read it to you, but if you, as you read it, you will see the types of adjectives that he uses, how descriptions that he uses, the metaphors that he uses, as he goes through each one of these particular, describing these two houses that sit off the road. And in the last one, a telect card had developed like a cataract upon the bleared panes. You can see the metaphors and things that he uses. And this is consistent throughout his writings, in which he has uses these types of analogies, metaphors, imagery, and so forth. The Bible is doesn't escape reference in the canon. In the Valley of Fear, Inspector MacDonald asks Holmes, "And what are we to do now?" And Holmes replies, "Possess our souls in patience and make as little noise as possible." And here are the passage, the Bible passages, "In your patience, possess your souls." Now, this seems to be a favorite of expression of Holmes, because he repeats it again in The Adventure of the Wisteria Lodge and again in The Adventure of the Three Garradives. He uses that same Bible passage. Monsignor Ronald A. Knox, a very noted theologian, and he got involved in writing the studies of in the literature of Sherlock Holmes in 1911. He raised the level of consciousness with higher criticism in a humorous manner when reading the stories, not only in finding inconsistencies within the story, but offering alternative interpretations as to what could be implanted to make the stories more credible. Dorothy Sayers, taking that same vein, wrote this quote, "The rule of the game is that it must be played as solemnly as a county cricket match at Lord's. The slightest touch of extravagance or burlesque ruins the atmosphere." And that's been going on now for years. A lot of people in 1940 says, what else can be written about Sherlock Holmes stories? And they continue today. The Baker Street Journal, you'll read essays. They continue to publish four times a year. They have essays that deal with that. The Sherlock Holmes Journal of London, as well as other conferences and publications that take place. There's a lot of literary criticism that goes in with these particular stories that embellish and enhance what happens during these stories. When confronted with the events that are factually, they take into a deeper level of consciousness, a place where curiosity arouses us to learn more about factual places, persons, and circumstances surrounding the happening. For example, in one of my writings, in which I wrote for the Baker Street Journal, in The Valley of Fear, Three Missing Words, it talks about the Pennsylvania mining community. And so it got me interested in reading more about the Pennsylvania mining community, what was taking place, you know, during that time period between the coal miners and the coal owners. And that then gives you a deeper understanding of not only with the story itself, but also enhances your own knowledge of the conditions that were taking place during that period. Sherlock Holmes begins each case with a starting point that directs and focuses his attention to a permanent fact, and a fact is a record of an event, okay? It is the focal point of a case where Sherlock Holmes activates his schema and begins his reasoning process. He places himself into a world of uncertainty where critical and imaginative thinking and reflection take form. Signs are revealed, and understanding with the code that they represent are the decision points for the inquiry. This world of uncertainty and the decision points necessary to make meaning are the signs different from the examination that he quickly imposes on visitors that come to see him at 221B. When in the world of uncertainty, Holmes is deliberate, slow to act, and measures his thought processes before rushing to conclusions. He formulates hypotheses based upon existing clues and their possibilities for interpretation. What Holmes uses is, and you know, people talk about deductive and inductive reasoning, and that's part of it, but what he does is, I believe, is he uses more abductive reasoning. And abductive reasoning is best explanation based on observations. And what happens is he starts from with the consequences, what happened, to the causes, how it happened, and then to the explanations why it happened. And this is a technique and a process that was advocated by Charles Sanders Peirce in 1903. He was an American philosopher, he was a scientist, and he was also a mathematician. And what this does, it enables Holmes to read, interpret, and make meaning with those signs as they appear within a given case. Clients come to see him at 221B, and this is basically how the stories are laid out too, when you read the stories where clients come. Sherlock Holmes is forewarned of their arrival. It's usually either by a telegram or by a calling card or a letter that he receives. Their appearance is scrutinized, and although this is the prerequisite, it's not necessarily a pertinent part of the story. Then the client elaborates on a problem. Each problem is either of the utmost importance. The socioeconomic status is labor, upper middle, and aristocratic that come to see him. Time is essential. And then reflection, which is very important, is the most intriguing trait of Sherlock Holmes, which is uncertainty, this backward reasoning process, inverse reasoning that I just mentioned, and also the reading of the signs and codes. And he does employ the scientific method when he does this. When he goes through this reasoning process, he then acts and then starts out to reach a resolution on what's being given to him based on what the clients have told him. And then they include value claims, which is the so what. How does that enrich one's understanding with what has taken place? 90% of the clients that come to 221B are from the upper 18% of the population of London. 0% of the clients are from the poor section of London. And 10% are working class, 90% middle class and above that come to see him. There's reasons for that, I think, but I won't go into that now, but there's probably reasons on why he doesn't take a lot of clients are from the poor class. Signs, codes, and uncertainties. I'm just going to mention really brief, just by one, but I gave a talk last year at the University of London, Sydenham House, in which I gave a paper on signs, codes, and understanding, and how Sherlock Holmes uses signs that appear in the stories and how he makes understanding from those signs. But as an indicator, I just want to see one. Now, who knows? Anybody not know who that is? Anybody not? No, obviously wouldn't be here. Okay. So the point is that signs do not give us meaning. We give meaning to the sign, any sign that we come into. And in this particular case, we give meaning to the sign because of the fact of the deerstalker cap, the silhouette, and the Meerschaum pipe, right? We know that it represents Sherlock Holmes. And he does a lot of this with the signs that the clients give him, signs when he goes to the crime scene that enhance his understanding to find out what's taking place at the time that it is. Here's a short clip I'm going to show you, Robert Downey, and I'm just going to set it really fast. This woman is at a table with him, and he tells her how she's coming into possession of this necklace that she's wearing and all the other things. But this is where he gets into trouble. He gets into trouble by then moving on and saying, oh, I see that you're not engaged anymore. And you'll see the reference made to the finger where the ring was and so forth. And it has an unexpected consequence that I think we have to be careful if we want to do the same technique with people that we know.
However, the jewels you are not wearing tell us rather more.
Holmes.
You were engaged. The ring is gone, but the lighter skin where it once sat suggests that you spent some time abroad wearing it proudly, that is, until you were informed of its true and rather modest worth, at which point you broke off the engagement and returned to England for better prospects. Doctor, perhaps.
Okay, so that's it. So what happens is he makes these kinds of observations, but not such a good idea. She didn't quite care for him. Now let's take a look at abductive reasoning in another setting, and this is from the Red-Headed League. And I'm going to show you some examples of abductive reasoning when Jabez Wilson is a client who visits Sherlock Holmes. This is the video that's portrayed by the Granada series, in which Jeremy Brett is in, and Jabez Wilson comes to consult him on the difficulty that he's having.
Oh, sorry, Holmes.
No. You couldn't have come at a better time.
I was afraid you were engaged.
I am, very much so. Dr. Watson shares my love of all that is bizarre and outside the routine of everyday existence. It is at present impossible to say whether this case is an instance of crime or no. But suffice it to say that I know as little about Mr. Jabez Wilson as you do yourself, beyond the obvious facts. That he has done manual labor at some time, that he takes snuff, that he has been to China, and that he has done a considerable amount of writing lately.
How in the name of good fortune did you know all that, Mr. Holmes? True as gospel, I once did manual labour. I started off as a ship's carpenter.
Your hands, my good sir. The muscles of your right hand are more developed than the left.
And the writing?
What else could be indicated? Why, the right cuffs are very shiny for 5 inches.
And the left sleeve, the smooth patch near the elbow, where you lean it on the desk. A china.
The fish. Tattooed immediately above his right wrist. I have made a small study of tattoo marks, Mr. Wilson, and have even contributed to the literature of the subject. That trick of staining the fish scales a delicate pink is quite peculiar to China. When, in addition, I see a Chinese coin hanging from his watch chain, the matter becomes even more simple.
Well, I never. I thought at first it was something clever, but now I see there's nothing in it after all.
If you read the Sherlock Holmes stories, you see that this is a trait that comes over and over, where Watson's astounded that once he's explained, he says, oh, yeah, that's not very difficult, and so are some clients. But I want to go back into the actual reading of the story, okay, and how it's depicted. When Watson sees Jabez Wilson, he takes a whole different approach than what Sherlock Holmes does. Let's take a look at what Watson sees. I'm gonna have to fire this woman. When Watson, in the story itself, he says that Jabez is a common British tradesman. He's obese, he's pompous, he's slow, he has baggy gray shepherd check trousers, soiled black frock coat, drab waistcoat, and so forth, a heavy brass halberd chain, and a square piece bit of metal, and so forth, to the freight type hat. He sees these superficial things that Jabez Wilson is portraying. Now, let's look again in the story now at what Sherlock Holmes sees when he sees Jabez Wilson. When Sherlock Holmes, there's a sign and there's a code. The code is the understanding that he brings to it, okay? So in this particular case, the right hand larger than the left with muscles more developed. To Sherlock Holmes, that understanding is to him that he's done manual labor, okay? In the story, it talks about the arc and compass breastpin, and for Holmes, that means he's a Freemason. And the Freemasons, it's against their order to take snuff, in which Jabez Wilson does. And then the right cuff is very shiny for 5 inches, left with a smooth patch near the elbow to rest upon the desk, which means he's done considerable writing. And then the tattoo, the staining of the fish scales, which a pink Chinese coin hanging from the watch chain, and therefore he's been in China. Now, actually, in this case, Sherlock Holmes makes a lucky guess. Even though he's smug in what he says and he's made a study of tattoos and all that, there's a problem with this, and that is that the signs that are exhibited by Jabez Wilson, first, he may have either purchased the arc and breast pin or it could have been given to him by someone else. That necessarily means he's a Freemason. The coin with the square in the middle could have been Japanese and not Chinese, since both coins have the same square insert in them. But more importantly, here's the distinction. Sherlock Holmes is mistaken, and he makes an assertion regarding the tattoo. It's more likely that the fish tattoo also signals a Japanese referent, since in China, tattooing was done depicting human figures and flowers, not fishes and animals. Okay, so that's a discrepancy in the story in which, and then he says, I made an extensive study, I've written about tattoos, okay? When confronted with a problem, Holmes assesses conditional probabilities, and he reasons through them by altering and reorganizing patterns of meaning as new information becomes available and synthesized. It's during these meditations that he evaluates the well-worn paths taken by the police and then enters into a higher order plane of reasoning that often places him in the mindset of the perpetrator. It's his ability to reconstitute the events by analyzing, discarding, synthesizing, reorganizing information, and then, which is very important, imagining how this mosaic can be interpreted and made visible that distinguishes Holmes from his rivals. An example is shown in this video of the Sherlock Holmes BBC. In this example, we're going to see a visual portrayal of his thinking process of reorganizing meaning. And what the Sherlock does in this particular case is he's trying to assemble various images with the word hound, okay, H-O-U-N-D, and a place called Liberty. And if you look closely, you'll see a Memphis referent within this.
Thank you.
Okay, so you see this example of reorganizing patterns of meaning in a visual sense as opposed to within the context as a mental activity. I'm going to move now into the scientific method and the forensics of Sherlock Holmes and a couple of things that he does. Sherlock Holmes, through the stories, has achieved fame through his scientific and methods not only in America during this time, but in Egypt and also in France. And Richard Saperstein writes that the first crime laboratory was started in 1910 by the French criminologist Edmond Leckard, who was inspired by Conan Doyle's The Adventure of the Sherlock Holmes. His name is known throughout Europe, and in one of the stories, in the Greek interpreter, Mycroft exclaims, "I hear of Sherlock everywhere," in the sense that there were things that were starting to take place. His writings on the use of plaster Paris for preserving clues, differentiating forms of tobacco, collecting dust samples, and so forth, are methods that are applied throughout the world in police agencies. So a lot of the crime laboratories and things that evolved from the stories themselves before they actually became part of the actual forensics used in police laboratories. The scientific method which he employs consists of stating the problem, forming a hypothesis, devising a methodology that collect data, make an implication, and posing future research inquiries with the results. And then forensic science is really the application of scientific knowledge and methodology to legal problems and crime investigations. In one of the books I wrote, I did a research book. I thought it would capture maybe somebody's kids' interest, students, I should say, college and high school. And I used the picture of the Musgrave Ritual. But each chapter, what I've done is I introduce it with a Sherlockian quote, you know, to guide them through this kind of a research process. But this is very important to me, I think. It's matter out of place. I was reading The Varieties of Religious Experience, A Study in Human Nature by William James, and in the series of essays that he's written, he just mentions matter out of place, not in the context of which we're going to talk about, but simply as matter out of place in another context. But it really is within this context of Sherlock Holmes and mysteries and crime solving that matter out of place becomes very, very important. For Sherlock Holmes, the scientific method is prompted by a clue, matter out of place. When confronted with a client or a crime scene, he quickly surveys the person and the scene to gain preliminary insights. In these circumstances, order is not systematic and in place. Instead, order is displaced by another object or event and becomes a source of interest and pursuit. With clients, it may be a coin dangling from a watch fob, a tattoo, it may be a sign of a worn sole inside of a shoe, a facial feature when people come to see him. Now, when we see footprint in the dirt, that's natural. We expect to see footprints in the dirt. If we go to a beach and we see footprints in the sand, we expect to see that, okay? That's not matter out of place. That's normal. However, when it displaces order and becomes out of place, such as a crime scene, it then becomes unique, okay? So too our bicycle tires, which in the Priory School story, they take, there are different types of sets there. He also disguises hoof prints, the other perpetrator does, with cow track prints. And then we also see the thumbprint on the wall in the Norwood builder. But Sherlock Holmes relies on matter out of place to clarify uncertainty and to bring order out of chaos. And I think that's very, very important to keep in mind. This is Sherlock Holmes and the scientific method. Dr. Hans Gross, an Austrian, has been called the father of criminal investigation. His criminal investigation, A Practical Handbook for Magistrates, Police Officers, and Lawyers, written in 1893, is a fundamental guide for criminal investigation and forensic science. In fact, if you go on the internet and look this up, you can still see a copy on there. And it's a lot of the things he's talking about, blood traces and so forth, are still relevant. They use that. Professor Ralph Turner was an eminent forensic scientist who founded the first police laboratory in Kansas City, Missouri, and the founder of the American Academy of Forensic Science. And he made this association between Dr. Gross and Arthur Conan Doyle, Sherlock Holmes, and I quote, he stated that both Gross and Doyle's descriptions of methods of collecting and interpreting forensic evidence were strikingly similar. So you can see that Conan Doyle, when he wrote the Sherlock Holmes stories, it wasn't just something he had predicated on some evidence that was taking place and what was happening. The evolving technology and the sophisticated process of DNA blood analysis provide retrospective study into the procedure introduced by Conan Doyle's Sherlock Holmes, with the first mention and the description of the blood identification test in a story The Study in Scarlet, which was written in 1887. Watson first meets Holmes, who's engaged in an experiment that he assumed to discover an infallible test for bloodstains. And this is a clip from the television version of Sherlock Holmes. Ronald Howard.
It works. It really works. Do you realize you've just entered the greatest chapter in the history of forensic medicine? You're Dr. Watson.
Yes, I am. What works?
A foolproof test for hemoglobin. You realize what this means, of course.
No, I don't. You must be Sherlock Holmes.
It will create a revolution in criminal investigation. Yes, I'm Holmes.
How did you know I was Watson?
Because you've just come back from Afghanistan. How do you do?
How you do? How did you know I'd just come back from Afghanistan?
Well, it's written all over you. The problem has generally been that a man is suspected of a crime months after the crime is committed. Then when they find bloodstains on objects of clothing, they can't be sure if it's blood, mud, or rust stains. But this solves the whole thing, of course.
Oh, of course. Of course. Stanford told me you're looking for someone to share a flat you'd found.
Do you know, if this test had been in existence a year ago, it would have meant that von Bishop of Frankfurt would most certainly have been hung. And that goes for Mason of Bradford, Muller, and O'Fay, naturally.
Naturally. Who are these people?
What he's saying in this film, in this particular clip, is that if this procedure had been in operation, that they could have solved a lot of other crimes based on the bloodstains that they had seen at that time. And bloodstains and traces of bloods occur in several of the stories of the canon. In the story, I think it's on the next, is there a slide on that? Yeah. In the story, The Study of Scarlet, there's the word rache, which is written in blood on the wall. There are bloody footprints found at the Burlston Manor in the Valley of Fear. Also in a tenement house on Howell Street in The Adventures of the Red Circle. And then curiously, blood marks appear on the floor of Hugo Oberstein's house. But when the body of Cadogan West is found lying on the railroad line, there isn't any sign of blood in the Bruce Partington lands. Victor Hathaway is shown to Dr. Watson's surgery with a blood-stained handkerchief wrapped around his head and the engineer's thumb. And when Holmes examines the upstairs bedroom, he finds traces of blood upon the windowsill and drops of blood scattered upon the wooden floor in a man with a twisted lip. Now, bloodstains arouse the curiosity and pose complex uncertainty for the official police, because what happened was, and if you take a look at this test, during this time and up until fairly recently, when they analyzed the blood, they could tell you the type, A, B positive, O, but they couldn't tell you who it originated from, okay? And so in 1992, I wrote that a blood stain originated from that particular person cannot be made since there is currently no method of assigning individuality to any particular person. And that was true up to a few years ago. And so I talked with Billy Fields, who's part of our Nashville Scholars Group, who in turn got me into the Metropolitan Police Department. And Tabitha Bullock wrote me back a long explanation on how DNA works. And really, what it boils down to is, in present day now, the DNA capabilities have now made the distinction that blood either did or did not originate from that particular person. So you can see now where it's really evolved into the technology that we now have today. excuse me. This is the, what I've done is I've taken the scientific method and I've applied it to Arthur Conan Doyle's, what he says Sherlock Holmes does with the blood identification test. And you can see that the problem, the research question is first. In other words, does the stain reveal the presence of blood? Second, what chemical substances are needed to combine and reveal the presence of hemoglobin in the stain? And then third, when distilled water, a drip of whole human blood, white crystals, and drops of transparent fluid are poured sequentially into a test tube, what can be deduced visually from the mixture? And then fourth, he used visual analysis to signify the change of mixture to a dull mahogany color. And then it was this contention that this test was the most practical medical discovery for years. And this, actually, Christine Huber in the 40s and 50s actually said this test was still used. Could still be used for that time period when they devised the story that he uses. So we can move on to the writing machine, okay? But this is another way in which he uses that he's in the forefront of what happens. The first successfully commercial typewriter was invented in 1864 by Christopher Scholes. and the use of the typewriter keys as identifying marks in solving criminal cases had its beginnings in a Sherlock Holmes story, A Case of Identity. Mary Sutherland, a prominent character in this story, was a typist. However, references made to the use of a typewriter in other cases where Laura Lyons had a typewriting business in The Hound of the Baskervilles, and Lady Hilda Trelawney Hope takes the role of the typist when answering an advertisement about typewriting in The Adventure of the Second Stain. Conan Doyle made an entry in his diary when he completed A Case of Identity. On April 10th in 1891, in his diary, Conan Doyle's diary, this is what he wrote, quote, he said, "It's a curious thing that a typewriter has really quite as much individuality as a man's handwriting. Some letters get more worn than others, and some wear only on one side." A Case of Identity was published in 1891, 23 years after the first practical typewriter was invented in 1868, and before such a technique was used in any actual case by the police. It was first given in that particular story. Let's apply the scientific method to the typewriter. He does the same thing. He states the problem in this particular case, who wrote the letter and why was the letter typewritten. And then the second hypothesis he formulates on why was there an absence of a signature on the letter, for disguise, obviously, by the person who wrote it. And then he conceived of a method to test it. And what he did was he saw that some keys were slurring over the E and a slight defect in the tail of the R was able to distinguish what machine that had come from. Okay? Now, based on these results, he's able to identify the typewriter and associate the person who typed the letter. This identifying procedure of typewriter characteristics has evolved into the 21st century and special traits exhibited by laser printers and copiers. First, I'm going to show you a quick slide here, a video of Hercule Poirot in 4 and 20 Blackbirds. Agatha Christie makes use of it.
"We have acquired a sample of typeface from the typewriter in your office, monsieur. I am certain that it will be the perfect match with the address on the envelope, the signature of the murderer."
All right, but not to be outdone, Perry Mason uses it also in one of his episodes, The Case of the Elusive Element.
"There's many differences between Chek's typed-on White Garrett's typewriter and Chek's typed-on Terry Clover's typewriter.
Though there are many areas of identifiable difference between the two typewriters, but notice in particular the chip letter N on White Garrett's machine.
It's this typewriter, this Chek, the letter N. All right, the time now, let's..."
Several years ago, I wrote that students can compare the events portrayed in A Case of Identity to typewritten messages typed on either a personal or a school typewriters, or to compare the type of letters and words to deduce fonts and type of printer, whether it be a dot matrix or a laser. But in 1894, William Hagen, wrote a scientific paper in which he said when typewriters first come out, they're relatively fairly equal. They have some distinguishing marks. But as with time, that these letters, keys start to wear on certain parts because of friction and so forth, and that they have the alignment features change also, so it's able to identify, and I quote from him, "A knowledge of this fact sometimes becomes important in tracing up the source of an anonymous letter printed by a typewriter machine." So you can see that there is an analogy to the actual scientific paper. The implications apply to science that affect our everyday lives. A laser printer, for example, can be identified by individual machines as ink sprayed onto paper. Crime laboratories are able to detect color printers, photocopiers by their nearly invisible yellow dots that encode identifying information in every printed page of paper. These minuscule dots serve as features that law enforcement agencies can identify as the case of counterfeiter currency. And you have to really magnify that to see the yellow dots. An example of yellow dots that you see there, okay, this is a watermarking process that changes the digital image so that the viewer can see the background image on the text without any corruption in the image. The imprint of those watermarks identifies and authenticates the owner of a digital image and serves as either a crime-solving measure or, in the case of preventing one from copying visual images of the originator. The watermark becomes part of the transferable process and therefore verifies the owner of the work. Invisible watermarking can be detected and is used in cases such as copyright protection, tracking, and annotation of photographs. Now, there's been another evolvement, and that's called stenography. And that's a form of secret writing that changes the images so that only the person who has electronically written the message and the intended recipient or able to decipher the message. Since the process is invisible, it is very difficult for someone other than the intended receiver to detect. Because of the innocuous visual display of a message, this process provides secret transmissions more readily than do messages that are either encoded or encrypted. Stenography appears in many forms, such as visual images, audio files, listings, articles, or as invisible ink written between the lines. This process is also effective when applied to information on computer files that are deemed to be secret. Such files include image files, document files, media files, etc. Since these files are typically large in size, stenography lends itself to this kind of deception. So these are things that are happening in today. Matter out of place, and I'm just going to briefly mention this with regards to footprints and fingerprints. In the stories in the canon, we reference both footprints and fingerprints. Clear examples of matter out of place, a thumbprint or a footprint, is evidenced in the stories when you read the Sherlock Holmes stories. In the Baskin Valley mystery, Sherlock Holmes is able to discern which footprints belong to whom and matches the culprit to his shoe identification, in this case, dirt out of place. Okay, here's a video of a short clip.
Now, why did Lana go into the pool, I wonder? Mm-hmm. Lana, take that left foot of his with his inward twist.
So if you take a look at this, footprints, dirt out of place, in the next slide, you can see that a footprint is a record of an event that I mentioned earlier. A can stand for something new that wasn't there before or is distinctive, all right? And so in this case, Sherlock Holmes in this story discovers the stone and he finds out that the stone is the murder weapon. And the reason is that he makes that insinuation is that the grass was growing under it. It had only lain there a few days and there was no sign of a place where it had lain before. And so it corresponds with the injuries that was killed the person, so he makes that analogy. But you're able to see matter out of place, either on the grass not growing on the stone itself or the footprint itself. Fingerprints, and I'm going to do this really quickly. Fingerprints, the scientific method as applied to fingerprints was emerging during the time of Sherlock Holmes in the Victorian era. Identification procedures were used in such cases as branding the individual, or taking physical measurements of the individual and other means that they used. But the use of fingerprinting as a crime-solving technique came to prominence with the writing of Sir Francis Galton, who wrote a book called Fingerprints in 1892. Now, and he talked about whorls, loops, and triangles that you could identify. But Galton wasn't the first one. Henry Fowles, who was a Scottish physician, he published a paper in 1880 suggesting the use of fingerprints, and he actually went to Scotland Yard and said, "This is our way to identify it," and they discarded it. They didn't accept his paper, and so it was with the continued work by Edward Henry that crime solving and fingerprints became part of the situation. Now here's a story of the thumb mark that appears in the Norwood Builder, of the Granada series, with Jeremy Brett.
Left McFarlane's hat and stick, and this is also where he would have come to collect his hat after the crime was committed. Now look at this. A thumb mark.
So I observe.
A thumb mark in blood. You are aware that no two thumb marks are alike.
I have heard something of the kind.
Although, yeah, it's kind of interesting. Lestrade is really well pleased. You know, do you see it? I've showed you the thumb mark and so forth. The problem is that Sherlock Holmes had already looked at that wall the day before. The thumb mark wasn't there. Okay, so that means it happened after, which now leads to solving of that case on what had happened. Now, a real case in which took place, the Stratton brothers in London kill a shopkeeper, and they actually kill his wife, okay? And a thumbprint, ironically and coincidentally, is found on the cash box, okay? And this is the first British murder conviction, which takes place in 1905, where they use a thumbprint to convict and hang these perpetrators.
Unbeknown to the Strattons, Scotland Yard sends its uniformed fingerprint team down to the crime scene. They find a bloody thumbprint on the shop's cash box.
Although the Stratton brothers clearly denied the offence, their fingerprints were found in the cash box. They thought they were going to be safe and free because they hadn't confessed. The only evidence against them was this little fingerprint, which they really didn't understand. but the jury understood, and still given a demonstration by the prosecution counsel, they crowned him guilty. The judge sentenced the Stratton brothers to death.
The bloody thumbprint found by Scotland Yard is the first fingerprint evidence to convict a British murderer.
And again, you know, it should be noted that this case was prosecuted after the publication of The Norwood Builder, which was published in 1903. So this takes place in 1905, but Doyle already writes about it in 1903. And it's just coincidental that they both use the thumb mark. Now, because of time, I'm going to skip over the cryptology and some of the other things that I wanted to do, because I don't want to keep you. If we can just move on to John Stuart Mill.
John Stuart Mill.
Okay, great. John Stuart Mill's philosopher, many of you know about John Stuart Mill's, and this quotation, is which he has in his stories, when you have eliminated the impossible, whatever remains, however improbable, must be the truth. Sherlock Holmes uses that in several of his stories, okay, in fact, many of his stories. But it really comes from John Stuart Mill's method of residue. They're stated in six of the stories that Holmes talks about when faced with improbabilities. He says, when you have eliminated the impossible, whatever remains, however improbable, must be the truth. Sherlock Holmes makes use of the scientific method as it applies to pertains to crime solving and the semiotic analysis of the events that occur within a particular case. And he extends this into other aspects of his study. Now, I just want to kind of talk about the value that the science give him. But to summarize, basically, what we're talking about is that Sherlock Holmes lives in a world of uncertainty, okay? He lives in a cosmos unto himself. He's different than other people, all right? His world attempts to bring order out of chaos emanating from client narratives. He endeavors to make the unfamiliar familiar, and that's the reasoning process that he goes through in his mental model. All right? Each client and case establishes a record of event that provides Sherlock Holmes with additional insight and enriches his mental model, which again is an organization of experiences and based on case knowledge and world knowledge. All of us have that to a certain degree, more in depth with certain topics that we are more known than others. And then each case is a record of an event, presents the reader with a glimpse into the reasoning processes with Sherlock Holmes' world of uncertainty. And then the key here is simplifying complexity is the goal when Sherlock Holmes engages in riddles and uncertainties in his investigations. Now, in The Adventure of the Dancing Men, Sherlock Holmes is quick to reproach Dr. Watson. And he does this a lot in some of the stories, but in this particular case, he says, every problem becomes very childish when once it is explained to you. You know, in other words, you read the story, and at the end he explains it, and then, oh yeah, I get it, okay? And so too, I think we, all of us, we have to kind of examine our own intellect as a problem solver, and we're confronted with various things. So I close with this thought, okay? It's not what we know, it's what we do with what we know. And sometimes people know a lot of things, but they don't do a lot with what they know. And that's basically it for tonight. I do want to explain one more thing here. I want to plug the Beacon Society. Now, the Beacon Society is a resource for parents, teachers, students that you can access. It has a lot of activities, a lot of things. It also is, we give grants. They just gave out 15 of them, $7,000 worth. And you can apply for the grant if you're working with Sherlock Holmes stories or with students and apply for it. And then in that book that I gave you, in the inside cupboard, explains how to do that. And if you go to that site, we also give the teacher award. And Shannon Carlisle, who's a teacher, won that award the year before last. And that's really hard to win because it's only one award is given in the United States. And she won that award from Williamson County 2 years ago. And she teaches at Moore Elementary School. So she was the recipient of that award. And it just so happens that last year, Tim Greer won it. And he was from the University School of Memphis. You know, he won that award. Now, this is not a Tennessee award, but it just so happens that the last two recipients have been. Now, I am the awards chair, but I was not the awards chair. I was not the awards chair when she won it or when Tim Greer won it. They asked me to do that last year. So I encourage you that if you have no people, the teachers or librarians and so forth, that want to apply for this grant. In fact, Williamson, this library won one of the grants. The Sherlock Holmes one last year. They did a series of novels. Here, Williams County Library got one of the grants year before last upstairs, the adolescent one. The other thing that I want to briefly mention too is Undershaw. This is the home of Arthur Conan Doyle, and as you can see, it's in disrepair, and my wife and I are very active in getting this preserved, okay? And we visited there a couple years ago, and this is what we saw, as well as other pictures. And so there's a big movement to restore that. And Mark Gaddis, who does the BBC Sherlock, and other people, there's a lot of money being derived to preserve this. And I just read just recently that they're going to make it a special education school. So instead of tearing it down and building condominiums, which they wanted to do, we're going to preserve that. And these are the books that MX Publishing, which is the largest publishing house, any of these books that are sold, and mine's over there, the third one, but any one of these books that are sold, all royalties go to, we give it to the Sherlock Holmes Preservation Fund for them. I'd be remiss if I had mentioned that Thomas Wheeler has a book called The London Sherlock Holmes, and it's interactive. And if you ever go to London and you want to visit some of the places or walk the streets where Sherlock Holmes walks and the different artifacts, you can download it, buy the book from AMX Publishing, download it onto your Nook or to your iPad, and then it's interactive. And if you click on it, it'll take you to those streets and give you the geographic locations and so forth that have been done with that. So, and again, I want to give you an invitation to come to the Nashville, Billy Fields isn't here, but I wanted to give you an invitation to come to our meetings. We have a scholar, a Nashville website that Jim Hawkins maintains, and the Nashville Scholars of the Three-Pipe Problem, in which it has our meeting dates. We meet the third Saturday of every month. We discuss a story, we have a quiz, we have a show and tell, and so forth. And it's an eclectic group of different people who come in and discuss our stories, which are pretty interesting, I think. And also, like I said, Tom Wheeler wrote a book. Also, we have another member of our group, Bill Mason, wrote a book called Pursuing Sherlock Holmes. Okay, so our group is very active, and it gets involved, and we have a lot of conversation and so forth when people do come. All right, anybody? And our members are here, so if you have any questions, Jim Hawkins, who's our webmaster, is right there, is very involved, and David Hayes is here. And Dean, if you want to know anything about movies, okay, anything about movies, Dean Richardson knows everything there is about movies going back to I don't care when. Silence, doesn't matter. He has all the information that... the Twilight movies, but he has all the information you ever want to know. I want to thank you again for your attention, and I appreciate the time and being here with you this evening.
Welcome to Poets from the Neighborhood. I'm Erin Glass.
And I'm Victoria Clausey. We hope you enjoy the poems we'll be reading to you today, poems that were written by your friends and neighbors. The first poem is titled, Io Underwater by Erin Glass. Ocean's pastures know the loneliness of being everywhere at once. Tonight, I have tunneled through the half-eaten stars to the most remote side of an octopus moon. This poem is a letter to tell you there is no home for us here either, or time enough to love without the fear of being too much or not enough of one thing. How do I say it? In this language, there are no words for how a cloud collapses, no road through the volcanic plumes, no sleep to close the peacock's eye. If you need me, I'll be this, dragging the past and painting it blue. But like the tooth that plunges out from the narwhal's head, I cannot tell you why.
Desert Dark Child by Susie Sims Irvin. Desert Dark Child, running knotted joints toward speeding tourist bus, drawn as a gnat to twin beams of light. Desert Dark Child, trailing red tatters from your slender mast, bleeding your purpled shadow, lengthened to absurdity, into still warm sands, stretching spindly fingers to gather to your tiny breasts bouquets of cascading nothingness. Desert dark child, I hear the silence of your futile cry, mimic echoes of this barrenness. I feel the frailty of your dirty fingernails scrape deep trenches across my hollow heart, my desert dark child.
This poem was written by 10-year-old Amanda Kate Danley. Raise your hand if you aren't here. Raise your hand if you're not here, the teacher said at the beginning of the year. Megan's not here, Courtney said. Next time, Courtney, raise your hand. But I'm here, Ms. Wimberly, Courtney said. Okay, then don't raise your hand if you're not here. Nobody raised their hand. Well, since I don't have a class, I have the day off. She ran out. So do we, the class said. They ran out too. Then Megan walked in. Hi, sorry I'm late.
From an ongoing argument with the Times by Jeff Harden. How long since you climbed the oak tree's reach for sky? How long since you crouched to hide your face in the long flowing cross-hatched swaying of sage grass? So what if the mailman sees you? He secretly wants to read all the letters and speak as an intimate while the store clerk weighs the seedless grapes. There was a time once, remember, you slipped out on water and set the oars to rest, the canoe like a thought that held you tucked inside. Over the tree line and then two hills you could walk all the way to the river and still be back before a soul would know you'd gone. You could do this every day. In another month or two, you'll lower northern windows. For now, cicadas ride the limbs of every tree for miles. It's a long way back, even from the last conversation you had.
Right Fielder by David Harris. Neatsfoot oil and leather, pounding ball into glove, wrapping glove around ball, marrying with a book strap, teaching ball and glove to belong together, binding the tools of summer to their tasks, possibilities, and prospects, binding myself to baseball. In March, we are all dreamers.
This poem was written by 9-year-old Amanda Danley. Spring. Trees beautiful with blossoms and fresh green leaves, ponds full of tadpoles and frogs, grass, wheat, and dandelions all waving in the wind, raining day after day, but finishing in beautiful spring colors of a rainbow. Thank you for watching. We hope you'll join us again soon for Poets from the Neighborhood.
If we want to keep the blue in the sky, the green in the trees, we better care for the air we breathe. That it would truly be a breath of fresh air when we all can see forever through the air we breathe. So let's really try to be more aware of what we can do to clean up the air we all share. So let's you and me roll up our sleeves, let's do all we can and care for the air we breathe.